Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to welcome Ruha Benjamin from Princeton University in African American Studies to this conversation. I'm David Theo Goldberg. I direct the University of California Humanities Research Institute and hold faculty positions in comparative literature and anthropology at UC Irvine. Ruha, do you want to say a word about yourself?
Sure, I'm thrilled to be here with you, David. Over here at Princeton, an associate professor of African American Studies and the founder of what's called the Just Data Lab. And so thinking about the data that's being produced in this moment is something that's been keeping me busy as well.
Great to hear. So we're here to discuss current conditions around race and racism and their underpinnings, especially in the United States, but of course the way it's both impacting and being impacted by other parts of the world. And so we're going to kick off this conversation with Ruha saying a few words about what immediately has produced the current condition.
Yeah, I mean, within about a week of each other, widespread attention came to the cases of Breonna Taylor and Ahmaud Arbery, who were actually murdered in March, but in part because of the attention consumed by the pandemic, we didn't learn about it until late May. And so the family's relentless sort of advocacy, the attorney, the shared attorney across those two families sort of brought it to widespread attention. And then within a very short period of time, as the outrage grew around that, we saw in real time, really, the murder of George Floyd. And then close after, even several other public murders. And so it's this really convergence of police violence and the pandemic during this pandemic that I think has created a really unprecedented moment and sort of has the floods in terms of people on the streets around the world, not even just in the US. But I think partly what we are here to reflect on is how it's not just kind of the eventfulness of these murders, but the slow violences, the structural, the everyday racisms that then we get a glimpse of in sort of converging in these moments. But I think it's important for us, if we're really going to reckon with what produces these spectacular forms of violence, to deal also with the everyday forms of violence that don't get headlines, that don't get hashtags, if we're ever going to really change that orchard that produces these rotten apples, as it were.
Right. That's a very important point, the relation between the eventfulness of what gets paid attention to, not least in and by the media, and then that ramifies across the population, and the underlying everydayness and the structural conditions that produce that everydayness. One of the immediate aspects of that everydayness, of course, was lockdown in the US, which was just starting. I mean, it was the weekend in which people were, getting back into public when the George Floyd murder happened. That, captured by a 17-year-old on a cell phone, a young black woman, with other people trying to intervene and the police sort of telling them to back off. And the first is the utter casualness and callousness and almost disinterest with which the murder took place, right? I mean, the knee on the neck was just, look at yourself.
He was so cool. I mean, his hands were in his pocket.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, it's the kind of coolness and casualness, exactly, as you say, of Derek Chauvin alongside the cries for his mother of George Floyd that was so pronounced, in that moment.
So it was the way in which that event kind of opened up the window, effectively, not just to other events, but opened the window to being able to see, a number of structural conditions. I mean, the pandemic had put a focus on the deep inequities in health availability in health systems, in the fact that African Americans, Black people in the US generally, suffer comorbidity conditions to a much greater degree than most others in the population, not least high blood pressure and hypertension, which are effectively the product of living in and with racism over time.
Yeah.
The relation to that, to being policed, which another cause of stress. I mean, Black people generally, Black men in particular, can't go out with fearing that they're going to be stopped, unreasonably, unnecessarily.
Yeah.
And then also the, a less visible condition, and you should wear in here, has been the relation to deep environmental injustices that mark U.S. society. So there are cities, in the face of global warming, there are cities, areas of which inhabited by people of color, which are, as much as 10 degrees Celsius hotter on any given day, or colder on any given day, right, to the wealthy side of town, right? And those discrepancies, precisely because there's no greenness in those areas. So the, those three things coming together, and then of course the enormous economic impact of those events coming together, exacerbated by the pandemic, and then open up a window to all of us.
Yeah, I mean, I love that you brought in the environmental racism aspect, because then the first part of your reflections, I was thinking about, this public health concept of weathering, that is the slow sort of day-to-day wearing down of the body because of all of those other experiences of discrimination. But then it becomes, in fact, explicit in terms of weathering and the environmental aspect of it. And I was thinking also in terms of the fact that, what precipitated George Floyd's murder was that a shopkeeper called alleging that he used a counterfeit $20 bill and that he had lost his job because of the pandemic. And so we get the economic crisis directly sort of channeling into the conditions that produced his literal death. And so when we think about the role of the police as not simply being licensed to kill, but licensed to keep this powder keg of inequality sort of contained, right? Where during the pandemic, we have 40 million Americans now and counting who've lost their jobs, George Floyd being one of them. And that in the same period of time, the richest billionaires, their net worth has increased. That means they have made more in 2020 while so many millions are suffering than they did in 2019. And so this is the weather in which George Floyd becomes one tragic case of this economic precarity, leading to this encounter that is designed to be deadly if you are Black. And so I think we have to reckon with the role, to recognize the role of policing in that, but that when we zoom out, there's so many other tentacles that converge to produce almost the inevitability of one case after the other.
Right. You point to the economic